everyone. So today we'll be discussing about examination of nose, paranasal sinus and nasopharynx. In the last video we talked about examination of nose, in which we covered examination of face, examination of external nose, nasal vestibule, anterior rhinoscopy and posterior rhinoscopy. So now continuing with the examination. So we will be talking about functional examination of nose. A part of the functional examination, the nasal patency test, has already been discussed. So the other one is smell test. So with this we are checking the function of olfactory nerve, the first cranial nerve. So the patient is explained about the procedure. He is asked to keep his or her eyes closed. Ask the patient to identify the smell of a solution of or substance held before the nostril. Its nostril is tested separately. Common substances used are clove oil, peppermint, coffee, essence of rose. Ammonia stimulates the fibers of cranial nerve 5 and is not used to test the sense of smell. The patient may feel the pungent smell, that is not actually the sense of smell, but because of irritation of the fifth cranial nerve. Commercially available smell test kits can also be used. The most acceptable one is University of Pennsylvania Smell Identification Test Kit. So it consists of 4 test booklets, each containing 10 stimuli for smell. All 40 stimuli are presented in rectangular areas like this. The subjects scratch and then sniff them, and they are required to pick from 1 to 5 multiple choices present in each stimuli. So we grade it according to the number the patient gets right. So if it is 36 to 40, it is normal, 0 to 5 malingering and anosmia or partial anosmia. So with this you can be able to assess the smell of the patient. Next, coming on to examination of paranasal sinuses. So on physical examination we have to examine the maxillary, frontal, ethmoid and sphenoid sinus. So examination of maxillary sinus, it is examined by inspection, palpation and transillumination test. Maxillary sinus has 5 walls, and except for the posterior, all other walls can be examined directly. So the areas to examine are soft tissue of cheek, lip, lower eyelid and the molar region. You have to see any swelling, edema or congestion in this area. Orbit and its content and the vision of the patient. Maxillary sinus disease may erode the inferior orbital wall and may present with orbital conditions as well. Vestibule of mouth by everting the lip. There may be fullness in the vestibule or any erosion present because of the maxillary sinus disease, mainly malignancy conditions. Upper alveolus, teeth and palate should be examined. If there is any oroantral fistula or any bulge in the palate because of the mass in the maxillary sinus. In nose, you do anterior and posterior rhinoscopy to see for any discharge or mass arising from the maxillary sinus, any mass in the middle meatus area. Tenderness is checked by pressing over the canine fossa. You hold the head of the patient with one hand and then press on the canine fossa. So one maxillary sinus should be examined at a time. Transillumination test. This test nowadays is not so commonly done, but historically important, and it is done by placing a specially made light source centrally in the mouth and closing the lips. Normally glow in the cheek, known as the Hughes-Voltolini sign. Crescent of light in the inferior fornix and glow in the pupil, which is known as Davidson sign, which should be equally bright on both sides. In normal case, in the presence of pus, thickened mucosa or neoplasm, the affected site does not transmit light. This test has limited value and has practically been abandoned in favor of new radiological modalities. So this is about maxillary sinus. Then coming on to examination of frontal sinus. It is also examined by inspection, palpation and transillumination. Frontal sinus has three walls, anterior, posterior and floor. Only the anterior wall and floor are examined in external examination. So the areas to examine in case of frontal sinus are: examine the front forehead, root of nose, orbital margin and orbit and its content. So in this case as well, you have to look for redness, swelling, fistula, proptosis and displacement of the eyeballs, because the eye is in close relation with the frontal sinus here. With the superior wall of the orbit being part of the floor of the frontal sinus. Tenderness of the frontal sinus can be elicited by pressure or percussion with a finger on the anterior wall above the medial part of the eyebrow, or by pressing upwards on its floor above the medial canth. So you press floor of the frontal sinus here. So superior orbital wall, you press here and check for tenderness of the frontal sinus. Nose should be examined by anterior as well as posterior rhinoscopy for evidence of discharge in the middle meatus and for any neoplasm. Then transillumination test. It is done by placing a small light source in the superior medial angle of the orbit and observing the transmission of light from the anterior wall of the sinus. It is compared on both sides. Transillumination of frontal sinus is of limited value and has practically been abandoned in favor of X-rays. Posture or postural test was previously done, but it is rarely done nowadays. Previously used to differentiate between frontal and maxillary sinusitis. Nose is cleared of nasal discharge and patient is made to sit up. If discharge appears in middle meatus in sitting position, it is coming from frontal sinus. If it does not appear, patient is made to lie down on the unaffected side for drainage of possibly affected maxillary sinus and checked. So this was a crude method for checking whether the discharge was coming from frontal or maxillary sinus. Okay, now moving on to examination of ethmoid sinus. Ethmoid sinus is divided into anterior and posterior ethmoid groups. The former drains below the middle turbinate and the latter above it. They are examined by inspection and palpation. So the areas to examine include examination of orbit, upper and lower eyelid, root of nose, eyeball, and then check for vision. So in these areas you have to see for any swelling or congestion of the eyelids and corresponding areas of the ethmoid sinus. Tenderness can be elicited only in the anterior ethmoidal sinus. This is done by gently applying pressure on the medial wall of orbit just behind the root of nose. The area is tender in acute ethmoiditis. So you have to incinerate your finger behind the medial canthus deep inside so as to palpate the ethmoid sinus. So on nasal examination, you have to do anterior rhinoscopy, which may reveal pus, polyp or growth in the middle meatus, which signify anterior group of ethmoid sinuses, or between the middle turbinate and the septum in case of posterior group of ethmoid sinuses. Probe tests should be done to find the consistency, attachment and friability of the mass. Posterior rhinoscopy may reveal pus or growth below or above the middle turbinate. So this is about ethmoid sinus. Now examination of sphenoid sinus. Sphenoid sinus lies deep and it is not easy to examine directly. Generally we are not able to examine the sphenoid sinus. Sometimes its anterior wall can be seen in atrophic rhinitis or in marked deviated septum. In anterior rhinoscopy, sphenoid sinus opens in the sphenoethmoidal recess. It may show discharge, crust, polyps or growth. A probe can be used to palpate the mass. In posterior rhinoscopy, it may reveal pus in the nasopharynx or the guana above the middle and superior turbinate. A growth of polyp may also be seen. Palpation of sphenoid sinus can't be done. Now coming to examination of nasopharynx. So physical examination of nasopharynx is done with anterior rhinoscopy, posterior rhinoscopy, nasal endoscopy, digital examination of the nasopharynx, and we have to examine the cranial nerves and cervical nodes in for the disease condition in nasopharynx. We have talked about anterior rhinoscopy in detail previously. So if you are going to examine the nasopharynx directly, then posterior rhinoscopy is the common method. So abnormal findings in posterior rhinoscopy may be discharge below the middle turbinate in cases of anterior group of sinuses, or above the middle turbinate in infections of posterior group of sinuses. Crusting may be present in atrophic rhinitis or nasopharyngitis. If there is mass present in nasopharynx, it may be smooth pale mass which may be anteroconal polyp, pink lobulated mass in angiofibroma, irregular bleeding mass may signify carcinoma. All these features are seen with posterior rhinoscopy mirror while doing posterior rhinoscopy. Smooth swelling arising in the roof of nasopharynx may be thormal cyst or abscess. Irregular mass with radiating fold may be adenoid. Irregular mass filling the lower part of guana may be mulberry hypertrophy of inferior turbinate. Bleeding seen may be because of posterior nasal or nasopharyngeal pathology. The other thing is digital examination of nasopharynx. So this is how you do digital examination of the nasopharynx. The examiner stands on the right side of the seated patient and holds the patient's head against his left hip. The patient is asked to open the mouth and his cheek is pressed between his teeth by the left hand finger of the examiner to avoid closure of the jaw. So the examiner guards his finger from biting by the patient by insinuating the cheek inside with this hand. Okay, then the examiner passes the finger of the right hand behind the soft palate into the nasopharynx. Palpation may be needed in doubtful cases of malignancy of the nasopharynx. In children, it may be done for adenoids. This is an unpleasant procedure for the patient and seldom done nowadays because we have nasal endoscope or flexible endoscopes to see the nasopharynx. So endoscopy for nasopharyngeal examination: a rigid nasal endoscope 0 or 30 degree and 4 mm is passed through the nose after local anesthesia and decongestion of nasal mucosa. It gives a bright and magnified view of the nasopharyngeal structures. So this is the guanal opening, and you can see laterally eustachian tube area opening. This is the roof of nasopharynx, the posterior wall, and fossa prosimula here. So all these things can be seen with endoscope. So using endoscope with different angle of view, it is possible to examine structures situated at an angle. Flexible nasopharyngoscope can also be used. It is also passed through the nose and gives a magnified view. Then examination of cranial nerves in cases of malignancy of nasopharynx. It can involve any of the cranial nerves from 2nd to 12th, more often the 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerve. So function of these cranial nerves should be examined. Examination of cervical lymph node. It is not unusual for nasopharyngeal malignancy to present primarily as a lymph node mass in the neck. Lymph node commonly involve are upper internal jugular and those along the accessory nerve in the posterior triangle of neck. So these are examined. Thank you for listening.